line, and no one can be kicked out, and that's a double-edged sword.
We hit any government we can find.
Just general anarchy, mayhem, and destruction.
Welcome to Inside, I'm Jenny Brockie. Tonight, hacktivism, hacking websites and online protests. We'll talk to hacktivists about what they do and why in a moment. But first, let's hear from one community called Anonymous.
Hello, citizens of the internet. This is Anonymous. We are not a group of hackers. We are simply a group trying to change things for the better. We are the embodiment of chaos. Chaos means change. We seek change, because when something is wrong, it needs to change. We fight where no one else dares to fight. We look in the lives of animal abusers and bring pedophiles to justice. We destroy the reputation of political and religious leaders alike.
It is true that Anonymous has committed what you would call cyber attacks in protest against several military contractors, companies, lawmakers, and governments. We do not fear your tyranny. Lock down the web. Throw us in prison. Take it all away from us. Anonymous will live on.
We are Anonymous. We are legion. We do not forgive. We do not forget. Expect us.
Welcome, everybody. Good to have you all here. We're about to meet a few hacktivists with unusual names and disguises that they've chosen themselves tonight. I'd like to introduce one of them to you, Bobby Tables. What is Anonymous?
Well, first thing, Anonymous is not unanimous. Most of the video that we just saw was correct, but we don't all agree. Anonymous is not a group. We're a group of groups. There is no leader. Anyone can join, and no one can be kicked out, and that's a double-edged sword.
You take part in Anonymous operations. What are you working on at the moment?
Right now, there's a fairly small operation in San Francisco where a homeless man, was shot in the back by police. And then the police tried to cover it up by attempting to confiscate cell phones. And then when a protest tried to get organized, they cut down cell service. So, for my part, the censorship aspect of it pulled me into the operation.
How did you get involved, Bobby, and why did you get involved?
I got involved because of the censorship. I saw, I believe it was Jillian York, tweet about it the day after cell service was cut, and then I saw Jacob Applebaum tweet about it, and I tweeted for about 5 solid hours about the censorship attempts by BART. I started making contacts on the ground in San Francisco, tried to get as many contacts as I could on the ground and start working on a direct action on the street.
And on the street, you mean online?
No, on the street. Like, actually on the street.
Okay, but using online to gather people, to organize people?
Right, mostly social media.
Yeah. Okay, Leto, I'd like to bring you in here because you're part of Anonymous too, but you've chosen not to wear a mask tonight. Why?
Well, I'm not doing anything illegal. I'm don't breaking any law, so I think I don't need a mask.
What sort of things do you do?
Spreading information, getting knowledge out, and animating people to stand up for their rights, basically.
Do you agree with everything Anonymous does when it hacks websites? Are you a hacker?
I'm not a hacker. I can hack maybe a tree, but I'm surely not a hacker of computer.
Okay, so you say you're not a hacker, but Anonymous does hack and does do that kind of thing. It doesn't bother you that you're associated with a group that doesn't do things that you don't want to do?
What other people do is their free choice. I don't see that people get physically hurt by hacking, so this whole terroristic call is wrong in my eyes. And I'm not breaking a law. If other people hack, if that's the only thing they see they can do, it's in their eyes okay, and I'm not the person to judge that.
Corpse, I want to talk to you. You're connected to a group called NetBashers. What targets have you hit? Has your group hit?
Specifically, we go for government targets. We really have no other specific targets, but governments in our eyes, it's just pathetic. They believe that it's all right to keep their citizens uninformed and just do whatever they want, murder civilians, murder innocents, go to war with countries that they have no right to, make up some just bull story and decide, hey, let's go to war with this person and kill all the civilians just because, you know, we claim they did something to us. It's happened in so many other times that we have seen, and the government always covers it up.
So when you say governments, what governments? How do you decide which governments to hit?
We hit any government we can find.
Any government at all?
Any government we can find. Any website, any government website that we can find an exploit on, we'll just hit it.
And what do you do when you hit it?
Whenever we hit it, we'll normally see, first we check to see if there's any personal details of government officials in the website database. If so, we leak it. Then we'll go after passwords. If we can get in, we'll probably deface it. But if not, we'll just post all the stuff that would be needed to other people. And if they have a chance, then they can do it themselves. But it really doesn't matter to us. We could care less about defacing. Sure, it's fun. Sure, we like to do it. But the most fun part for us on governments is exposing them.
Which governments, though? You said any government. So all governments are bad?
As far as I know, a lot of people still have faith in the governments, but in our eyes, every single government has been bad. They've all made a mistake and have all lied to the citizens at one point or another, and they still try and cover it up.
Chari, what about you? You're from a group called the Wongs. Are you a hacker, a hacktivist, or both?
I don't know. I'm just kind of in it for the lols. It's quite fun and funny.
In it for the laughs, yeah?
Yeah, pretty much.
So how do you decide what to do then?
I just do it. I don't really think. I just do stuff.
Who are some of your targets, Chari?
Ranging from the UK Prime Minister to the Mastercard.com.
What did you do to the UK Prime Minister?
Brought his website down for 3 days.
And why do you do it?
Because I don't particularly like him.
How old are you, Chari?
15.
Commander Grant Edwards, you manage cybercrime operations for the AFP here in Australia. Do you regard someone like Chari at 15 as a threat?
Anyone that has unauthorised access or modification of a computer system is a threat.
And do you regard people who do this kind of hacktivism as criminals?
Well, it's everybody's right in a democratic society to protest, but there are societal norms that we operate within that element of protest. Once you move outside that, and for this instance in terms of hacktivism, if you, again, hack into a system without the authority of the individual or the group involved, well, then you commit an offence and you potentially be prosecuted.
Mm. Later, what do you think about this? I mean, where do you draw a line about things like releasing personal information?
Personal information is exactly that area where I wouldn't go. I mean, leaking confidential information about governments and organizations, I'm totally okay with that. But private numbers of people who have a family released on the internet for prank calls, I don't want that to happen to me. So I could never do that to another person. And that's the basic problem I always have, is that people put private data of other people into the internet while not wanting their private data in the internet. So that's a bit of hypocritic, actually.
Okay. Corpse, is that true of you with the disguise over your face, that you're happy to release personal information about other people but not about yourself?
I'll take this mask off right now if you want me to.
Okay, but okay. What about the point about releasing personal information? Obviously, there are differences between you about where to draw these sort of lines.
Regular people's information I would not release I really wouldn't, because I find that to be worthless. Why would you put something like that? But if someone's not so innocent and they've done something to you or several other people, which would not happen to other people, they would not like it happening to them, of course, why not just give them a taste of their own medicine? But when it comes to innocent people that you know of have not done anything, why would you leak it? Government, would you really classify them as innocent? I mean, after how many of the military members have went over there and killed innocents, the presidents and prime ministers and all that have just turned around and lied to their people about everything that's been going on? Why would you count them as innocent? Why wouldn't you release their information?
Patrick Gray, you report on information security. You're a bit dismissive of hacktivists. Why?
I wouldn't say I'm necessarily dismissive of hacktivists. First of all, I've got to say that I don't quite like the term hacktivism. I think there's online activism, and I think there's hacking, and there's criminally motivated hacking, and maybe even politically motivated hacking. But just for some reason, every time I hear that term, it just makes me cringe, because you've got people who are out there doing everything from raising awareness online to organising protests to doing DDoS attacks against sites, and just to sort of lump them in as hackers just doesn't seem quite right.
What do you think about the range of what we've heard now?
This is the whole thing, right? It's sort of presented quite often in the press as being a unified movement. But I think what we've just seen is that it's quite scattergun anti-establishment stuff. There's no manifesto, there's no clearly defined goals or objectives. You know, and as Mr. Bobby Tables over there told us, Anonymous isn't a group. I've often compared Anonymous to being like pirates of the high seas hundreds of years ago. They all waved the same flag, but they weren't a group. There was no leader of the pirates. And I think a lot of people in media and even in law enforcement are confusing things like, they're confusing influence for structure. There are people within who identify themselves as Anonymous who are probably more influential and can rally the troops a little bit better than other people, but it doesn't make them leaders and it doesn't make Anonymous an organisation. So this idea that these hacktivists are coming to sort of topple governments and, you know, cause havoc, it just seems a little overcooked.
Alana, you study hackers. What's the difference between a hacker and a hacktivist, even though Patrick doesn't like the term? Well, we've got to call them something. What do we call them?
I don't know if I have a much better term, but I've always looked at it as security activists versus vigilantes versus, I don't know, I don't see some of the actions of the characters that we see on screen as being any different from the 15-year-olds who would go out and necessarily spray graffiti on the weekend.
No different at all?
Well, different in terms of if the claims that the type of information they're getting at the end of the day might be different, but that would be no different than doing graffiti and breaking into a place.
But it's different if you hack into something and release a whole lot of information that's otherwise protected. Yeah. That's not like spraying graffiti on the wall.
Well, we were just saying, yeah, that isn't, but at the same time, it's interesting to see that, you know, secure systems, or what we tend to think and trust to be secure, can be broken by someone, you know, in high school still.
Is that something that worries you, Grant?
Look, anything of this nature worries me because, as Patrick said, the exponential growth of the digital world is highlighting to us that our lives are being controlled by the internet, if you like. So our personal information, our daily activities, a lot of our life is involved on the internet. And if people have the ability and the desire to want to hack in and obtain that information or nefariously use your computer, for instance, a DDoSing, well, that's a problem.
We'll explain DDoSing in a minute because a lot of people won't know what that means. Soulette, you wrote the first book on Australian hackers with research help from Julian Assange. Are hacktivists much different to traditional protesters? I mean, is it different because of the breadth of information they can have and the way that they can spread it?
I think there are a few differences. So one element is the element of perhaps the feeling of being slightly detached because you're there with your keyboard late at night in front of your computer, and that's quite removed from a sit-in, you know, or a rally in person. But I think that there are, and I would jump in and say that I agree that the view Anonymous is not one entity, and indeed online activists are not one uniform entity, as we've seen here tonight. But I would say for that subgroup that is politically motivated in the sense of, you know, motivated by a cause, there seem to be some recurring themes. And probably the most important of those is a sense that information should be free and people should be free to protest, people should be free to speak out, should be free to publish, that right of free speech has been infringed and the right to free information has been infringed by government's increasing desire to censor the internet, to censor our ability to get information. And that is potentially, I see, the only possible unifying theme, really, between them. So I think that's quite important.
Mm. Coming up on Insight.
Loic is an anonymous application. You can download it in a couple of clicks to your PC or Mac. Once it's there, you can take part in distributed denial of service attacks, even if you have no clue how to hack.
Tonight we're talking to hacktivists. One way that they attack websites is through the distributed denial of service, known as DDoS. Here's how it can work.
Loic is an anonymous application. You can download it in a couple of clicks to your PC or Mac. Once it's there, you can take part in distributed denial of service attacks, even if you have no clue how to hack. With Loic running, your computer can flood any given server with garbage requests to access the website. Used en masse, the traffic from legitimate users cannot get through. The site is then effectively inoperable. That's denial of service. Last year, Loic acquired a new feature, the Hive Mind mode. This new feature turns your computer into a voluntary botnet, or internet robot. A botnet allows a single machine, called the bot herder, to take control of all the computers running Loic. The bot herder can then orchestrate the attack. So not only do you not need to know how to hack to take part in a DDoS attack, but now you don't even have to know the time or the attack target. Your computer is doing it for you, silently.
Grant, is DDoSing a crime?
Under the Australian legislation, yes, it is.
Okay, and how do you view it? I mean, how do our authorities view DDoSing?
Well, certainly the Australian government websites have been DDoSed and a number of other businesses have been DDoSed as well. That's tantamount, if you like, to taking away either an individual or an organisation's ability to undertake their business, or depending upon the type of DDoSing, an individual, its computer is involved without their knowledge.
Mm. And how widespread is it?
Well, certainly according to the internet industry, it's quite wide, yes. It's quite prevalent.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Sulette, how do you view DDoSing?
It can cause damage, but the damage tends to be very short term. So it might have a system that's down for an hour or a day. Obviously, it's not a good thing that a business would not be able to conduct its business, but it's hardly a crime worthy of a capital punishment. And it's certainly something that I would put in the realm, often, depending on the motivations of the people behind it, as potentially being something of civil disobedience. So, for example, someone goes and, you know, has a protest out the front of Nike and stops people from going in the store because there is a picket line out the front. It's akin to that, but it's online.
Mm-hmm. Jody, what do you think? You're a white hacker. You test security systems by hacking into them. What do you think of DDoSing?
I think the Loic DDoSes have been pretty laughably ineffective in the past. I don't think any of the anonymous operations have really been all that successful. There's one coming up against Facebook in the near future where they expect that if they can convince a few thousand people to download this Loic tool and point it at Facebook, that they'll be able to knock Facebook off the internet. But even if they were to convince a couple of hundred thousand people to download and run this tool, the amount of traffic they could generate with that tool would be a drop in the ocean of the amount of traffic that Facebook gets at any given moment on a day-to-day operation. So I think that the denial of service attacks that Anonymous have been able to carry out with this voluntary botnet have been ridiculously ineffective compared to the capabilities of the botnets that the real criminals, such as the Russian black hat hackers, have access to.
Black hat hackers meaning people doing it.
The real bad guys out there who have access to DDoS capabilities and real botnets, they're not interested in taking down MasterCard or Visa or Facebook. They're interested in making money. They don't want to take Facebook down. They want to make money off the people that are using Facebook right now. So they've got more important things to do than petty little political protests.
Do you think it's a legitimate form of protest to do this kind of thing?
No, I think it's a distributed denial of service attack. Well, there may be some legal grey area whether the user is actually voluntarily participating in it as opposed to getting infected with a virus and the virus makes them part of an attack. The way that a lot of these anonymous operations explain their attacks is to try to trick their users into thinking that they're just participating in direct action democracy, that they're just exercising their free speech rights. You download this tool, you run it, and you are exercising your free speech rights by doing a virtual sit-in or the website, when in fact you are participating in a criminal attack.
So people being conned is effectively what you're saying?
Oh, the majority of the people participating in these attacks are naive kids who don't know that they're actually committing a crime, and then they're getting busted for it.
Okay, Corpse, is that right? Majority of people are naive kids, don't know they're committing a crime with DDoSing?
A lot of people are getting involved in it that aren't really hacktivists. A lot of them are just doing it for the laughs, just to say, I tangoed down this, I took down this, blah, blah, blah. And they always put, like, I'm laughing. They always just try to say I'm laughing at it. They do it for no specific person or no specific purpose or anything. It's just pathetic.
Later, what do you think? I mean, Anonymous was mentioned here as being ineffective. What do you think about that?
Ineffective, I definitely wouldn't say. I mean, we saw it with MasterCard, Visa and other companies, government sites and everything. Also, this often used phrase of little kids not doing what they do, I think that's pretty wrong, actually. There are several people under the age of 18, of course. It's the internet generation, but there are also people in my age, people over 40, they know exactly what they do, they have a cause behind it, and they, as me, in fact, don't see DDoS as a criminal attack. It's a sit-in. If I go to a shop and stand in front of the door and block it, it's the same for me.
Bobby, what do you think of DDoSing?
I first want to say that I think it's ridiculous that the people who participated in the PayPal DDoSing in the United States got slapped with, you know, they potentially face felonies, which is, I think, the same as a capital offense. And if we're to agree that it's a crime, then we need to look at the punishment. And I don't think the punishment fits. People in the United States face 10 years in jail and $500,000 fines. And I don't think, you know, I think that there are people, I think it's wrong to say that most people are doing it for the laws, at least with regard to PayPal. People were very, very focused in why they were doing what they were doing. And it was a political statement.
Chari, what do you think about DDoSing? And what do you think about the description that a lot of the people are young people who don't really know what they're doing?
Who was the lady who said about Anonymous bringing down MasterCard and Visa?
Lato from Anonymous.
Lato.
Oh, Lato. Yeah, Lato. I single-handedly brought down MasterCard and Visa on my own. For over an hour each.
I'm sorry?
Chari is claiming that he single-handedly brought down MasterCard and Visa on his own for an hour each.
And you can ask Corpse about that because he was there as well.
Congrats. I'm.
Why is that such a good thing, though, Chari? Why do you think that that's such a good thing if you did do that?
Because it proves a point.
What's the point?
That corporations aren't secure as they think they are and they think they're untouchable when they're really, really, really not.
Patrick, you want to say something?
Yeah, what these guys are referring to, too, is that, you know, 14 people in the United States recently discovered that just because you call yourself anonymous, it doesn't actually mean you are anonymous. They got rounded up in a whole bunch of raids for using the LOIC software, the Low Orbit Ion Cannon, and they are facing really, really serious charges, and it is it strikes me and pretty much everyone in the group of people that I know that the punishment is indeed completely disproportionate to what these people are doing. A lot of them wouldn't have realised what they were getting themselves into. And it's the fact is, anyone using that software, it is entirely traceable. So I believe all that PayPal did was gave the FBI a list of the 1,000 originating computers, or the IP addresses of the top 1,000 attacking computers, and the FBI just batch processed a bunch of warrants and then scooped all of these people up. And now they could be in serious trouble. And of course, you know, the Department of Justice in the United States are putting out big, bold press releases saying they're rounding up members of Anonymous, and it was really seen as they were trying to play it like they were striking back against all of this sort of activity.
But you wouldn't expect them to do nothing.
No, and indeed, I mean, sending that message too, it's quite effective. I think it's effective strategy in the sense that people are starting to cotton on to the fact that if you participate in these sorts of attacks, there could be consequences.
So is that a good or a bad thing? Is that
well,
a good thing?
If you're law enforcement, that's a great thing. But I think what we've got to work out is whether or not there's a lot of discussion here tonight about whether or not participating in a denial of service attack is a civil right, whether or not it's, you know, civil disobedience, or whether or not it's going to remain a, you know, seriously punishable offence. So I think that's something for lawmakers to worry about.
For the little kid who was tricked into downloading and running a program on his parents' computer, who now faces 10 years jail because he was just trying to participate in some little thing he saw on an internet website. He didn't understand what he was doing, and now he's facing 10 years jail. The new version of Loic actually promises to work entirely within a web browser, so there's no downloading or anything necessary. So if you could convince 1 million people to visit a certain web page on a certain day, they can participate.
And what do you think of that, though, Jody, as a concept?
Well, I think they'll be able to. I think they'll be able to convince a lot more people to participate in attacks if all they need to do is click on a link on a web page.
But what do you think of the idea of those attacks?
I think the whole idea of these anonymous attacks could be very easily subverted to any cause, because anybody can claim to be anonymous. It's a double-edged sword. Anyone could create an anonymous operation. Anyone could go onto these anonymous forums and say, I'm creating Operation Attack SPS Insight. And on this particular day...
Do not suggest such a thing.
No. On this particular day, we're all going to download this Loic and we're all going to point it at SPS Insight. And we're going to take them down single-handedly for 1 hour to send a message to the corporation that
I think that's a frontline on PBS in the United States.
Exactly.
There was a denial of service attack against.
And it all gets grouped in with Anonymous, and it's just me and my friends and a few useful idiots that I've convinced to run this tool.
Okay, so there are dangers in subversion, is what you're saying.
Yeah, but it's the concept that any single one of us can be anonymous. There is no leader. Anyone can attack anybody as anonymous, and it gets ascribed to the entire group as a whole. And you can see just with the four members on the screen that all four of them have completely different ideals about what it is they're actually trying to achieve. And they don't all agree with each other, and they don't all agree with each other's methods.
Mm. There are two things I want to pick up here. One is the question of the punishment and people getting scooped up in this grant. And I just wonder what your view as a law enforcement officer is of that. Mm. I mean, I know we're talking about an American situation here, but I mean, how do you decide where culpability lies with these sorts of things when you're dealing with something like DDoSing, where, you know, heaps of people can be involved? And can you see dangers in the way that's approached, that there are, you know, potentially naive people who get involved who weren't at the heart of the operation anyway?
Absolutely. There's a couple of points. First of all, in terms of the punishment fitting the crime, I mean, that's where a court determines that. I mean, in terms of the actual criminal offence, in terms of, say, for instance, whether it be a hacking or a DDoS, that a crime has been committed, well, then we investigate that, we charge. It's the courts that determine the level of punishment in terms of the criminality that's taken place. But I think what's often overlooked is the downstream effect on individuals and businesses when, for instance, you know, someone undertakes a DDoS for the laugh of it. What happens is there's a lot of innocent people that are going about their business on a day-to-day basis that are either affected or impacted, whether it be for an hour or in some cases forever, where their websites or their businesses are lost. And what that does is that impacts on the confidence of the community. And that's where we get the situation of loss of confidence in the use of the internet to do our daily activities.
Mm. Bobby, what did you want to say?
I was just going to say that You know, these people who participated in DOS against PayPal are facing some dangerous rhetoric from officials in this country. Are we coming to the point where we call a 16-year-old girl at her computer in Iowa a terrorist? I don't think so. I don't think that's right.
I want to talk about a few other activities that are a little different to this. And later, I wanted to ask you what you did in what was called Operation Egypt.
Mm-hmm. Well, Operation Egypt, yes, was in the beginning of this year in the so-called Arab Spring, which is still going on, so maybe it's sort of Arab year, I don't know. Which was basically starting with real people demonstrating on the streets of Cairo and other Egypt cities, and they got punished for trying to speak up, trying to use their freedom of speech and trying to gather information. So yeah, basically, some parts of Anonymous tagged government websites. I didn't take part in that. As I said, I'm not a hacker or DDoSer. But we also spread informations of how people could get into the internet from Egypt, how they could get informations out, how they could get videos out. This we all know this picture of the people holding up their mobile phones, making videos and pictures. And we basically spread that information so media eventually will take it and make reports about it. The first days there was nothing in media.
What was DDoSing done during Operation Egypt? And obviously, attacking websites was done. Was DDoSing done?
Exactly. They took down Egypt government websites.
Mm. Okay, Grant Edwards, I just wonder what you think of that, because that's an interesting form of protest at a time when, you know, much of the world was behind what was happening in Egypt and that democracy movement. I mean, can you see in that context, would you condone something like that?
Well, certainly in that context, it's not within the Australian realm, but what I see there, clearly.
But it's an interesting point, isn't it? Because it can still be about attacking websites and it can be about circumventing censorship or doing all those sorts of things. But it might be for something that's actually, you know, got very broad support in the democratic world. I mean, is that a different case?
Well, I see there's two issues there. One issue is bringing to light issues lawfully, in the sense of wanting to have information passed about what is occurring. But secondly, what I see from that description is when you attack a government website, well then, and again, I can only apply this to the Australian perspective, then you commit an offence. So there's a difference in terms of you're wanting to be, if you like, lawfully undertaking a protest, and then encompassing with that, then attacking a website, which is, again, in the Australian context, an unlawful act. As soon as you access that website, you've committed an offence in Australia. And I'm surprised at how many people don't know that and don't understand that. That forever surprises me.
Mm. Coming up on Insight, what have you hacked, Cherry?
Well, I've done two sites in the last about 10 minutes. Thetechgame.com again and sbs.com.au.
Tonight we're talking about hacktivism, and I'd like to talk about some other consequences and what happens when people get caught in some of the crossfire with this. Josh, Sony emailed you to say that your account details, Sony PlayStation account details, may have been compromised this year. What happened?
That email that they sent was in response to the PSN network having been shut down as a result of what I'm aware of was a hacking of their PSN servers. From memory, what happened was the network went down with no real explanation as to why, towards late April, and that there was about a six-day gap between certain PlayStation network services not being available and the reasons behind that being made known to users of the service. I received an email from Sony to the email account attached to my PSN account, but was also aware of that particular hack through other means as well, like websites like Kotaku and NeoGAF, and just being an active gamer and member of the community there. It wasn't until that information was made available that people had realised their personal details may have been compromised.
Now, Patrick, tell us what it was about. What was the hacking?
Well, I don't think anyone knows. I mean, that's the thing. The PlayStation Network event, no one's really ever claimed credit for that. Sony believes that information on 77 million of its PlayStation Network users was walked out the door. Someone spotted something fishy, freaked out, and pulled the pin on the whole network, and the network was down for about 3 weeks. They understand that the information went out, but it's not like this credit card information popped up in underground forums being traded, for use in fraudulent activity. And it's not like, it was just put out there in a torrent or, put out there and made publicly available so that everyone could laugh at Sony. So it is actually a little bit difficult to tie the PlayStation Network.
Yes, that's very clear, and we're not trying to tie them together, but I'm just trying to make the point of how people feel about this idea of information being compromised in that way, of a hack being done and personal information being compromised.
I would be thrilled to have people under the banner of Anonymous steal my information from an insecure service rather than have a bunch of Russian cyber criminals steal it and then really use it for fraudulent purposes.
Are they the only two choices?
No, you've got plenty of others. You've got all sorts of casual attackers. There's many people that could obtain this sort of information, and really these guys are obtaining it and putting it out in the public. I mean, if they're getting access to it, chances are somebody else has already stolen it and are probably using it for much more.
Chari, what do you think of the Sony hack?
It was quite funny. How do I send you a picture, by the way? To the studio.
What is it?
It's just something I just hacked.
No. What have you hacked, Chari?
Well, I've done two sites in the last about 10 minutes. Thetechgame.com again and sbs.com.au.
Okay. And again, why? What is the point of doing this, Cherry?
Just to prove a point.
But what is the point again?
And for the lows, of course.
It's just that you can, yeah?
Yeah, pretty much.
Can I get back to the question I asked you, which is what you think of the Sony hack?
I think Sony deserved it in the end. It was pretty much in response to GeoHot getting arrested.
Okay, Michael, you had your information compromised as well. How do you feel about it? And how do you feel listening to this?
Well, quite frankly, I don't see any reason to hack the database to release personal information. Sony did something wrong, fair enough, if that's what they're after. But, 2 months before the last hack, which shut down the network completely, Anonymous stopped their hack and then basically said on a blog that they did not want to actually affect the users whatsoever. They were only after Sony. But then they went ahead 2 months later and, destroyed our lives for a while. I was scared.
Anna never took credit. The thing about being anonymous is that you actually don't do anything for personal benefit. You're anonymous. You don't get any accreditation.
Exactly. But the fact is still that my data and hundreds of thousands of people in Australia and plenty more out in the rest of the world was compromised due to this same type of hacking.
Well, Anonymous didn't take credit for this, did it?
Not that I know of.
Yeah. Later?
Initially, the website of the PSN network was DDoSed, yes. That was stopped 1 day or 2 days after because people were jumping into our channels and, bitching around. It's looking good in the newspaper, this mask, and oh my god, the bad terrorists of Anonymous hacked Sony, so gamers, please hate them, but we didn't hack Sony.
Okay, but Michael, the point that you're making is just that at a purely personal level, that experience made you feel vulnerable.
Yeah, if my personal information could be used out there in the world for someone to, say, get a mortgage out from a bank, and not pay that bank, then I've got a bad credit rating. So if that happens, I'm basically, I've got no leg to stand on.
Sule?
I should like to jump in here and point out that there are lots of different categories of hackers, and we've talked about hackers who do it for laughs, we've talked about hackers or just online social activists who do it for a higher cause. There are also hackers who just hack because they're curious or because they want to, because they can. Certainly from the hackers that I've interviewed from my research, a lot of those hackers are very silent, and they just go in and they get a piece of information, they get out. Now, they can be motivated by profit, they can be hackers for hire, involved in corporate espionage, or they can just be hackers who want to because they can, but they're never going to release the information. I don't think it's a good thing that private information is stolen that way. I think there's no point in targeting individuals. We should all be entitled to a higher level of individual privacy. But at the same time, there's every likelihood that that sort of private information will just never appear in public because the hacker has gone in, climbed his mountain and left.
Okay, Matt, you're a security specialist with a big company. What do you think about what you've heard tonight? And you won't use your last name because you're concerned about some of this stuff, yeah?
No, that's just the way I'm going to call myself. I think a lot of the attacks we're talking about are extremely opportunistic. They're very the easy targets, or it requires a very low investment to make these successful. And I think they're pointing out a much bigger problem with the state of security and the way it's being applied in organisations and the industry. So I think it's, while we're talking about all this and there's a lot of political and social conversation points, it's bringing up a much bigger issue and an awareness to security issues which are out there, which I think is important as well.
So what do you think the quality of protection and security is like in Australia?
Well, I don't have a perspective on Australia. I think in general, security is just, it's always a catch-up game, but at the same time, a lot of IT estates which are vulnerable, your security controls will only be as good as the quality of your IT estate. And technology is usually driven by people who want to build more and more and more functionality and make stakeholders happy and so on. So they're spending less money to do technology, and they're cutting costs, and they're accepting the risks which they're doing when they're doing this. And it's creating extremely complicated environments which are hard to protect.
Who would you hire to protect?
There are a lot of really good people in the industry, and research is, as I said, it's a lot. This is extremely opportunistic, what we're talking about.
But would you hire hackers? Would you hire someone like Cherry?
No. I think...
Would you hire other hackers? I mean, we hear that happens a lot. he just made a peace sign, apparently.
Well, it depends. A lot of people who are in security have had all sorts of interesting backgrounds. And Sule has written about this, and it's fascinating. But...
So maybe in 10 years if he behaves?
Yeah, well...
yeah. But he's 25 as opposed to 15.
Well, here's the thing. I don't believe in the people who are innocently affected, and I don't really have an opinion on the cause. I'm not really concerned about that. But from a technical merit, if they have the skills, then great. And that's where a lot of people are self-taught. They're creative. They've got good sense of humours and so on. And that's important. But... it's different. I'm concerned that the accessibility of this is too high and it's too easy. People are going to get into it, and law enforcement are going to make an example of a lot of these people, because it's showing where we are in the internet and technology, that it affects more people and it has a much bigger consequence.
Okay, Grant, do you want to comment on any of this?
Well, there's a couple of points. First of all, with security, it doesn't matter how robust your security system is, it's only as good as the weakest link. And it takes, for instance, in a business, an employee with a fairly innocuous password to open a gateway for people to get access. Similarly, many businesses don't even map their own systems. These people are quite expert at getting in and mapping systems on their behalf and identifying where the vulnerabilities are. Like our 15-year-old friend there is allegedly already hacked into the SBS site. So
it might not be hard.
Well, possibly not. What we have to realise is that the internet is so vast and so great, and it's running at such an exponential pace, that it's up to not only the individuals but also businesses to take ownership and responsibility for their own protection online.
Tell us about the new laws that are being proposed around retaining of information, holding of information.
Well, certainly there's a piece of legislation before Parliament at the moment which ostensibly will strengthen the current cyber laws, and one of those which will definitely assist law enforcement is for us to be able to request orders for preservation of information. Currently, many of the ISPs and associated entities are not obliged to maintain information. So what this piece of legislation will do, if it passes, it'll give us the opportunity to request preservation order whilst we go through our normal processes of obtaining warrants to lawfully access that information. Should we not be successful in obtaining a warrant, well then, of course, that information will be expunged. Secondly, it'll allow us to work collectively with our international law enforcement partners, because this is a borderless crime and we have to work with our foreign counterparts. It'll give us the opportunity at their request to be able to undertake the same opportunity. And thirdly, it will by strengthening these laws, it will help us in terms of signing the European Convention on Cybercrime, which is very important, because what that does, again, it brings in a global community of law enforcement to be able to collectively address cybercrime.
Okay. Response, Sule?
I have very serious concerns about this proposed legislation. One of the most important of these is it's effectively the thin end of the wedge to a wiretapping without warrant. For the period of time that there is no warrant, it is effectively wiretapping. And the other thing that I have very serious concerns with is the fact that it effectively allows overseas law enforcement to say, oh, we want information on this Australian, pass this information over to us now. That information has very few, if any, limits on what it can be used for. It can be handed to countries that have the death penalty. You can see a repeat of the Bali 9, which is, you know, extremely bad in my view. A number of these concerns have been raised by a joint parliamentary inquiry into the piece of proposed legislation. They suggested all sorts of changes, none of which were actually made in the piece of legislation that went through the lower house. It remains to be seen what will happen in the upper house.
Okay, to be fair to Grant, he's not a politician. So, you know, I think this debate is best had, and maybe we can have it online because we're running out of time and we can keep it going online. But, but you know, I think to question him about what's happened to the legislation probably isn't fair, given that he hasn't drawn it up. What I would like to just wrap up, because we are talking about hacktivists and we are talking about protest, and I'd like to just go back to the people we started with and ask you all what you feel you've achieved. I know Corpse has had to go and apparently had to go to school, so that's why he's left us. But Chari, what do you think you've achieved?
I don't know. I get quite a bit of Bitcoin donations, so I've got quite a bit of money out of it. Just general anarchy, mayhem and destruction, pretty much.
Bobby, what do you think you've achieved?
Oh, I don't know. Not too much today, but I would like to make a point on that last bit about the laws. And I hate to say this, but when laws are proposed that would help to benefit international partners, I'm glad to see diplomacy fail in certain countries, because we would use that to exploit our message. I would tunnel all traffic to that country first and then out to the internet. So unless all governments work together, you're not gonna stop it.
Leto, what do you think you've achieved?
Good question. good feeling for me. First of all, so being active in the fight for freedom of speech is something that gives me a good feeling. Second of all, well, we saw it in Egypt, we saw it in Tunisia, all the countries, Libya, that it comes into the press, into media, all these videos we saw first of people being killed in demonstrations, families being killed in attacks. Bringing that to knowledge, getting people to see that, to really see that and to experience that it's not somewhere far away, but that it's actually happening, that is, in my eyes, a very great achievement.
Okay, I'd like to thank you all very much for joining us tonight. Chari, take it easy on the SBS website. We're nice people. And thank you all very much for joining us tonight too. You can keep talking to guests on our live chat. If you're in the eastern states, just hop onto our website and click on the link. And join our Facebook page to keep talking about this and other topics throughout the week. Good night. Join our online chat now with hacktivist Bobby Tables and Commander Grant Edwards.